bigger challenges for larger firms because they are involved in audits of more complex audits. They are involved in more complex situations. And also, I think, but they have also some advantages because they are linked to their international networks. They have space for consultations. They can actually talk to people internationally. They can, but this facility is not available to smaller practices. But so we are talking about one or two individuals in smaller practices taking all decisions about the audit, which is fine. But I think the larger firms have larger risks and larger kind of resources available as well. So the situation may not be very comparable.
So the term professionally skeptic takes a whole new outlook, right? You just don't have to be professionally skeptic in your working papers and in designing your procedures. You now have to be professionally skeptic about how you report it.
Yeah, actually, if you think about it, it's also a reputation of the profession as a whole, that if we are seen as reporting not things which are very relevant, which are not reporting the right risks, etc., the people at large, investors, regulators, will criticize us that this audit profession is not actually looking at the right things. They're still looking at, they're still applying procedures which are
archaic,
obsolete. They're doing things which are actually from the older days, which should be modernized. If we are describing our procedures and they are not considered a sufficient procedure, a smart procedure in the situation or environment that we are performing them, then obviously this, I think we all have to think about the impression of the profession which will go through these key audit matter reporting. So it's a lot at stake, I think.
Farooq has a comment to add. Okay, yes, sir.
I would like to share one point, Arslan, that there is one thing which I believe that obviously this is the point which the auditors need to consider, that don't you think that there is a need of coordination between the audit firms also, which is more now, because like if, for example, there are two auditors which are doing the audit of say one same industry like oil industry or say service industry, now the point is that the first auditor say has reported the three industry points which are the key audit matter scam, and the second auditor is totally doing the different thing. So don't you think that there is a possibility that someone can come up and say that how is it possible that the other auditor is totally...
I think it's an interesting question, but I'd say yes or no. Yes, because it will give you kind of a landscape to think more and coordinate more and standardize more. But is it really what is required? Because each firm at the end of the day is a unique firm. And they have a viewpoint, and they would like to provide their unique perspective to the audit. There should not be standardized perspective to the audit. So there's a firm which believes that this is our judgment, and this is the way we look at the audit. And the other firm, and this is a point which differentiates one firm with the other. And this is something which will maybe considered by the businesses when they appoint firms as auditors. Not only that every firm and every company is similar, I think that's a mindset we should come out of.
Yes.
Because every firm is unique and you should be paying attention to, as in a competitive market, what you're buying.
But I think every business is also unique, isn't it?
Yes.
Every audit should have its own story. Why should one story be just copy-pasted and splashed around in newspapers all around?
And this is the danger.
Actually, what has happened is
we would all sound like all these news anchors, right? Because they keep harping about the same issue over and over again.
What I am saying is that if for each sector, all the auditors came together and came up with standardized key audit matters, then it would become boilerplate key audit matters. Then they will not take care of the specific situation of each company, actually. Because each company has specific circumstances, it has to be a case-to-case basis. Each company's audit is different, auditor of each company is different, his judgment is different. So there are so many factors. So if you put in one company three different auditors, I bet you all three auditors will come up with different kinds of key audit matters.
Yes.
And with different wordings as
quite
well.
Quite possible.
And Farooq, what would you want to add to this?
I want
There's
to
a
give
huge
a
mix
slightly
coming
different
around.
Perspective. I think what I'm hearing, and to an extent I agree as well, that we are a little apprehensive, what kind of key audit matters will come, how people are going to do it. I think it should be taken as an opportunity as well. How good we are, how good as a profession we are, how many things we are looking at it, how comprehensive is our audit. There is a lot of work, and I'm very, very confident that the profession is doing excellent work. If you look at the audit files, you will be amazed. I being in the field, I know for many a companies, there are files which go into hundreds, and there's so much work that is done. Their auditors were spending day and night on a particular audit.
But is it
audit,
smart
so
working?
No, what I'm saying is that let's be confident about our work as well. The key audit matter should come, it should come through the flow. There is no change in the way the audit has been done. There is no change in any other standard. I will be a little technical, like already ISA 260, that requires on the auditor to report certain matters. Those are mandatory, those are the requirements. It starts with Shell. So those matters, the significant findings, and there are certain other matters that are required to be reported to those charged with governance. And if we are following those, the only thing that we have to do is, out of those matters, we have to look at on what matters we have spent the most attention. So the matters on which, if we have done a proper audit, aren't we aware where we have spent most of our time? Aren't we aware in what matters we have engaged the audit committee and those charged with governance the most? So this is already done. So I think there's another perspective. Let's be confident. We are doing some really good work. It should come through the normal audit process. However, what needs to be done is, because now the key audit matters will be public. These are published. So we need to have a very strong documentation to support how we have come to the key audit matter. So if we have reported a matter to those charged with governance and we are not taking that as key audit matter, then there should be a justification or a working paper file that this is the reason why we have not considered. And if we have chosen to have one matter reported to those charged with governance as key audit matter, the same principle applies, and the work paper should be able to demonstrate why this was selected as a key audit matter and should have a working paper references. So what I'm saying is that it should come through the normal flow of the audit. All the work has already been done, already been communicated, and just what we need to do is that through that flow, we have to select and report with a proper documentation in our working paper file.
I also believe that, you know, the CAM would also be supported, because there is nowhere it is stated that something should, you know, sort of prop out the first time from the auditor's report. There has to be a harmony between what is being reported by the management in the director's report, in the annual report, on all the other things, and what is being reported in the audit report. So we would be drawing a lot of strength from the fact that the management is on the same page as we are when we are reporting those matters as key audit matters, because we cannot afford to have two different viewpoints in the annual report.
You know, on this, the standard itself very specifically says in the application guidance that we should avoid, the auditor, the key audit matter, should avoid to be the original source of information.
Yes.
So if something has, if not in the financial statements, it could have been in the board of directors report or in the chairman's review or wherever, like in the dissemination to the stock exchange. So we should not be the original source of information. However, it does not stop you. It does not say that still if there is some matter which somehow the management has not reported either in the financial statements or through other means, then still you can, but you need to avoid it. So the guidance is that you avoid to be the original source of information, but still, if there is some, you can. But in that case, you have to be careful that if this is such of importance and it is not part of the financial statements, then you need to see whether the proper disclosures have been made or not. So whether
I think
it has
indirectly, the CAM will improve the financial statements as well.
In the
when
fourth
you come up with various camps that look, these are the camps that we are going to improve, the management would be probably inclined to include a disclosure in their financial statements to that effect.
And it would
so
also encourage engagement.
Will accordingly increase, improve.
And it would also encourage engagement of the audit committee at very early stages of the audit. And, you know, greater engagement on all levels between the auditors and the management.
You know, in the revised fourth and fifth schedule, now it is a requirement that you have to give a summary of significant transactions in the financial statements. So if there is anything which is significant, the management, the company is bound to give a summary of that. So, of course, your key audit matter should be from a significant matter. So I would imagine that there will be a lot of correlation on the key audit matter with the summary of significant transactions or events during the period. I think one thing we should all be very clear, I think Arslan also touched upon that, but very clearly the key audit matter has to be from the current year. It must be a point of significant attention in the current year audit. If it was significant in the last year, no. The key audit matter by definition is from the current year. This is something very specifically we need to note.
Come on, sir.
Sure.
Yeah, sure. Can we have a mic, please?
My name is Aslam, and I have three small points, and elaboration may be long or small, depends on you. Mr. Mirza spoke about what's happening in the UK. I think there's a great learning what's going on between FRC and there, and the big four firms, and what the House of Commons Committee is doing to the FRC. There's no qualms about the type of report, etc. Slowly and gradually, we get used to it first, then the client will get used to it. After all, there are also qualified people working in family-owned companies, in listed companies, in corporate sector. So there's a lot of internal communication there also. There is also new structure of board where independent directors are there, professional directors are there. Audit committees are working for the last 10 years, more than 10 years. So can in our whole this discussion, I didn't see anything which gives us some learning why despite all these audit procedures, why all these big and bigger firms are being fined by FRC for their quality of work. After all, if we get into that, we probably see what we actually need to do with regard to this report. Its report seems in English very simple, but I think there's a lot of hidden things, message in the way we conduct our audit. So, sorry, that's one point. Number two, in the report they say profit or loss. There's a change. We always had profit and loss. Now I would like to say if there's loss, do I only say loss and omit profit part, or I still have to say profit or loss? Because in the opinion paragraph, now we say give a true and fair view of the loss of the organization for this period, or we say profit for the organization. Or we still continue to say, despite the fact what the profit and loss says, we say it's a profit or loss true position. Just a minute. My third point is, and then you can communicate. With all these key points, issues, I have seen Rolls-Royce report I've projected there, and Vodafone 6 to 8 pages. What do you think will be size of the report of PIA here? Thank you.
I think it's BI is now beyond reports. But profit loss account is we are talking about, I think, in the opinion, profit loss account rather than profit or loss. So the opinion is give a true and fair view of the balance sheet or the financial statement of financial position and profit loss account. So whatever is in there in the profit loss account, so we are giving an opinion on the truth and fairness of the account itself.
So we have to say more
profit loss account. And I think about the audit failures, I just wanted to comment that I think if you think about it, please, we are a profession like any other profession. There's doctors, I think there are people who die because of the negligence of doctors. There's a profession, lawyers, they lose cases. Sometimes they are negligent. If you take any other profession, there is always a chance that people will not behave exactly in the manner in which they should in certain circumstances. It doesn't mean that there's something wrong with the profession itself, something wrong with the organization itself. So certainly there are always lessons to be learned, but I think this, if we expect that there will be a zero audit failure, there will be zero kind of a situation where a professional may be negligent, I think that will not happen in this world. So what we can do best is obviously to learn lessons from the audit failures, continuously strive to increase the quality of the audits. And this is a one step in that direction, because we are now opening up and offering ourselves to the to anybody who wants to understand what we have done and who wants to understand how we have applied our thinking process in terms of or vigilance or how we have exercised our diligence, etc. and etc. So that will be much more open for anybody to evaluate. So I think, but still, if we say because of that we may be able to avoid any audit failure or negligence in the future, I think that may not be possible.
Okay, I think we've talked enough about the challenges that we may be facing from the audit committees or the profession or whatever. There is one very, very important element in this mix that we haven't talked about, and that is the regulator. It could be NAB, or it could be the SECP, it could be the ICAP quality control, or it could be our own member firm network quality control.
It could be Supreme Court of Pakistan.
It could be the Supreme Court of Pakistan also, agreed. What if, this is just this hypothetical situation in which we as auditors or the management in tandem with the management have taken a certain view on a certain issue, and we've reported in a certain manner. And the regulator, one fine morning, decides that there is another view to it, or it should have been looked at from another angle altogether. How do we address that risk? Because that in itself creates news, and it is exposed. This is what we're going to do, and this is probably what we're going to face. And especially in organizations which are public sectors and where we are doing the audits. I would like a take of everyone on this, please, because everyone has a stake in it.
I think to the extent we can demonstrate that we have, as auditors, have exercised our diligence under the professional standard framework, we are okay. Now, even after exercising our professional judgments, complying with the standards, etc., even if you miss out certain important issues or matters, I think it's a defendable position.
But it's not about missing out, it is about something that you've reported, Arsalan, and the regulator has another viewpoint altogether about it.
Yeah, so again, is it about the facts that we are, are we stating facts which are not right?
Like, for example, I'll give you something from my own personal experience, that there is always a concept of materiality when we talk about audit and when we talk about reporting. Obviously, when we are reporting key audit matters, it is about material events also. Let's say in a public sector entity, which is there are regular frauds and financial frauds that are happening, we may not be able to unearth them because of the materiality and because of the procedures that we've designed. And it is, let's say, unearthed in one of the inspections that takes place by the regulators, etc. And then there you are standing in a court of law or in front of an inspector explaining your position that, you know, it was not material to what you were doing. And yes, but yes, there is a fraud, but it was not unearthed, it was not material. There are a number of things that would be happening.
There are two things. One, I think we are also explaining in a very greater detail about the audit process and responsibilities, in which I think we're talking about materiality concept, control, reliance, et cetera, and et cetera. So every user or anybody who's reading the report should report in a holistic way that this is the audit process that that was performed. And in terms of the fraud risk, I think if we consider that really there is a fraud risk which is very, very important, and this is a key consideration in our audit, then one would expect that you should be highlighted as a key audit matter that how you have addressed that fraud risk in the, because if a situation should have taken cognizance the high level of fraud risk, then one would expect that you explain how, as an auditor, you have mitigated the fraud risk under the requirements of the professional standards that you have.
I think, you know, you still have a very valid point, because I think the audit report, be it in the previous format or the revised one, more elaborated, covering more audit areas, and you have done the best, you have given your best shot, you have performed all the procedures, but still you will be questioned as far as certain regulators are concerned. I am of the view that we have to categorize the regulators first. I mean, talk about the Institute of Chartered Accountants, or SCCP, or SPP for that matter. And you can, you know, put FIA or NAB, and then ultimately High Court, Supreme Court into a different category. So first of all, I suggest that the first set of regulators have to be on the same page as far as understanding interpretation of the report is concerned. Because that also has a significant impact on the day-to-day activity, even of the existence and survival of a practicing firm. For example, you know, ICAP has the quality control procedure in place, you know, which gives a rating of satisfaction as far as quality is concerned to the audit firm. And now we have an oversight board in place and ultimate regular SCCP. So we have to be on the same page initially. Whatever measures need to be taken, when Farooq, you know, was chairing our committee, auditing standard ethics committee, we have been deliberating on various options, including workshops, roundtable conferences, just to make sure that all the regulators and users mostly are on the same page. And number two, of course, if whatever you do, I mean, you can't, I mean, it's going to be almost impossible to bring FIA or NAB onto the same page. But as far as these prime regulators are on the same page and auditors is adhering to his ethical and professional responsibilities with the best of his skepticism available, he still had a chance to plea his case and defend his case. And even in those cases where, as you said, that because of the inherent limitation of sampling material, there are certain materials that might not be detected. And those agencies who have a very focused and specific targets and objects of investigation, they are very, they have more probabilities and chances, of course, to, you know, dig out few things which auditor might have skipped because of sampling procedure, one way or the other. So I think the first set of regulators have to be on the same page, including the auditors.
Another, just a slight comment. Any chances of us auditors being made scapegoats by our own clients in front of the regulator?
There's going to be a lot of rotation, I think.
मैं आपको चीज कहना चाह रहा था कि difference of opinion or interpretation of laws or regulation between the regulator and let's say the regulated हर जगह दुनिया में होते हैं, I mean SCCP, United States वगैरह, but you know there is a mechanism of sorting it out. You know, it's not accusation that you say you're corrupt or you're incompetent. It's different interpretation होते हैं. Unfortunately, in Pakistan, for the last few years, we've had an environment where the higher judiciary has intervened, superseding the regulator as well, or the interpretation of the regulator. So, it's a rather complicated issue. And I will give you an example of this because it's public domain. So I don't have to be shy about it. I was on the board of National Bank between 2000 and 2003, and the bonus was approved by the board to the then president. And somehow it landed up in the court of Mr. Bakhar Chaudhary, and probably 12 years after I came off the board, I got a call from FI saying, Ji, aapne bonus approved kiya tha. Maine to nahi kiya tha, board nahi kiya tha. Anyway, to cut a long story short, despite my telling him that the auditors found nothing wrong, and the two auditors at that time, and the State Bank auditors also having approved it, he said, you know, it's just because the chief has said that, so we just have to go through the drill. So, yeah, in our, we have this problem.
I think I'll just say one word. Actually, as far as the regulators are concerned, we should be concerned about SCCP and Audit Oversight Board right now. We should not be talking about FIA or NAB. Because
even SCCP can take a different view, sir.
No. That there, what my point of view is that if we include some matters in key audit matters, we will include them after considering all their implications, after discussing them with the audit committee and the board. And then if we have done our work fine, right, we have nothing to fear about. We have nothing to fear from the regulator, or we have nothing to fear from any law enforcement agency also. And we should have the courage to do the right work and do the right reporting. If we are not doing that, then we should be afraid.
Okay.
And we should be then open to scrutiny as well.
Yasser had something to say.
Actually, I think that if you ask me from the industry point of view, the issue is that we all understand that there is no change in the audit or the audit procedure. Audit is the same. There is no change in the audit. It's just only the reporting side which is slightly or changed. So it is the more important thing would eventually be there are two aspects of it. Either there can be issue of non-reporting a camp, or the drafting of the point in the camp. These are the two aspects which eventually can pop up and can create problems. I think the scapegoat side, the question which you were referring is practically it should not be the case, because the management is also supposed to report the significant matters. So ideally, the management and auditors should be on the same page. Now, if you come to the drafting side, I personally feel that this can be an issue, especially in the first year, because it will be new. Regulators we have been discussing like SCCP or these FIAs and NABs and everything, but I think the problem can be more from the tax authorities, who are short of their taxation targets. And the problem is that normally when we see the contingencies or the camps, there can be many camps coming from the contingencies or areas where judgments are involved. So there is always a risk that if there is some issue in the drafting, the taxation authorities, especially in the first year, they can come up with some idea that you have taken a stance on it, and even the auditor is saying this thing. So although it can be handled, I fully agree with Kamran Saab, but these are the issues which we can foresee in the first year. But obviously, we should not stop anything, or we should not be discouraged about anything just because we can face some problems in the first year.
Yes,
and
sir.
The situation will be slightly, I would like to add one more thing, that the situation can be a bit difficult or can be interesting in the sense that this year, the whole disclosure requirements are also now, for the first time, the Companies Ordinance, Companies Act 2017 will be applied, so new disclosure requirement will also be applicable. So from the industry point of view, we will be applying the disclosure requirements, and there will be a new audit report also. So I think that drafting is more important, drafting is the more concern for the industry, that it should not be drafted in such a way that the taxation authorities or somebody can come up and say that there is a slight concern even of the auditor. And I think from the auditor's point of view, there is a possibility that your drafting should be comprehensive and articulated in such a way that it cannot be questioned about the conclusion of the auditor whether the audit report needed modification or something like this.
you should have one more concern, Yasir, that you might be wary of the fact that orator might not, while drafting can, you know, disclose certain confidential information which are very sensitive to a particular industry. That could also
be
one of your major concerns.
That can be a major concern.
Yes, Farooq, you needed to add something.
To ask a question as a auditee. Now, with the new scope of audit, does that mean increased?
There is no change in scope.
No, sorry, the word scope is wrong.
Key audit matters.
Okay. No, I'm saying, I want to know as a question. Does this mean more work will be required to be done?
Yes.
Which will translate into higher fees?
Yes.
I was
okay.
About to come
so,
to
so,
it.
So, no. I'm just telling you the nitty-gritty of this thing. I think, you might find that this will be a bigger issue than anything else. The biggest resistance you might get is that that the clients might feel that, well, look, you.
It's
you
your
do,
problem,
you want
not
to do
ours.
More work?
No,
you pay for it.
I don't know.
No, I've always supported high fees, but I think, this should be communicated to the auditees. This is coming, and they should not grudge you that. Quite frankly, I think you have a resistance.
I think on a lighter side, we can also put audit fee as a key audit matter.
जहाँ पे कम होगी वहाँ डाल सकते हैं ना?
Because lot of time, I think.
It just don't justify the effort required.
Sometimes I think you're working at such a low fee that your independence will be questioned. What is the reason why you're doing that audit?
जी, Farooq needs to add something.
I think the risk is real. As far as I'm aware, all the listed company financial statements are reviewed at the SECB level. All the financial statements of listed company every year, annual financial statements, are reviewed at SECB. So 100%, that's my understanding, ke wahan iska review hota hai. Certainly, jitne bhi key audit matters hain, वो उधर से स्कैन एक तरीके के होंगे एंड एक्सपेक्ट मोर लेटर्स मे बी क्लैरिफिकेटरी यू विल बी एबल टू एक्सप्लेन के जी क्या है बट एक्सपेक्ट मोर कम्युनिकेशन फ्रॉम द रेगुलेटर एक बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट रेगुलेटर जो मेंशन किया महमूद ने दैट इज़ द ऑडिट ओवरसाइट बोर्ड जो कि एक नया फिनोमिनन है And I have been regularly interacting. In fact, I wrote to them to come to this seminar as well. But they are Islamabad based, so they will be attending the session on Friday that is happening there. So at the AOB level, they have also hired certain inspectors. And up till now, the interaction that we had with AOB. I feel that there will be some form of review at that level as well. They have not very explicit about it, but that's what I gather.
That's the whole purpose of setting it up.
Exactly.
Right?
So now, not only the SECB level, but also at the Audit Oversight Board level, there will be more scrutiny, I would say, of the financial statements and especially the public interest companies. So expect. More questions, expect more communication that we have to see. And that is why when I said that our working papers should be able to demonstrate that why we have not taken a particular matter as key audit matter, as well as why we have chosen to have a particular matter as key audit matter. So long as we are able to demonstrate to our work paper files that this is what we have done, I think we should be good. But there will be more time to be spent handling all this. And certainly when there's more time, I think it should be appreciated by the companies that there's more cost, more time involved.
To you about AOB.
Yes.
Is it now
Kamran Saab has set down his glass. Just,
is it
it's just an indication of how serious he is.
When is it becoming part of EFIR? So two questions to you.
They have they have done a review of the ICAP.
I think they've done a PCOAB already, isn't it?
They have done a QCR framework review, and yesterday we received a report from them. They have made a number of observations, and that's a preliminary report, a draft that they intend to discuss. So that will be discussed, and there will be changes in the framework, because that is part of the law as well. So that will be dealt with.
Please bear with me, because I've been patiently waiting. A couple of comments for the sake of clarity here. Key audit matters does not affect anything at all. All the qualifications, disclaimers of opinions, and other matters, like matter of emphasis, remains as it is. And Arslan, this is my understanding, that it will not have any bearing on other matters. It is just the storytelling part. Okay, so the idea is the auditor must tell whatever they have been doing. So this is how it has been evolved. Now the audit has come out of the dark area. Obviously the auditor was considered to be operating in a black box without having to know to the public as to what was the process followed in order to arrive at the conclusion. So now it is out of that black box, and you have to tell the general users as to what was the process. So it could be possible that the similar industry companies having, you know, two different auditors having two different camps in a similar, operating in a similar environment. So it is obviously their own experience in the process. And the, on the judgment area, this is only the first step, as we see it, because the world is changing. With the introduction of AI and the technology, the audit books have to be all rewritten. Okay, so we have to be ready for that. And it is to just to understand that, if we all are cricket lovers, so if you remember, there used to be times when there used to be a judgment call by the umpire, and everybody was looking at the finger of the umpire when there was a run out or a no run out. And then the time changed. And now there's no judgment involved. It is accurate as, you know, it is there or not there. So it is exactly going to happen with us. The judgment is going to go away. The artificial intelligence will take over. And there would be very little room for the auditor to play on the judgment. So these are my takes.
I think it would be a very sad day, because audit is all about judgment. It will be a very sad
You see, it's actually a US phenomenon. They always think that somebody's going to come and take over the whole world and everybody will become redundant.
I don't think
we're going to become redundant in the next 10 years or so. So you'll retire as a partner, don't worry.
I think even there will be a lot of involvement of technology in audit, but I think at the end of the day, audit inherently is judgment. So because you have to form an opinion, right? So opinion means a judgment, and you have to consider factors to form an opinion. So far as it remains an opinion, you cannot take away judgment out of it. I think regarding emphasis, I think there is a guidance in the standard itself, which talks about the interaction of key audit matter with the emphasis of matter. And it is my understanding from that guidance that in the situation where you are covering certain matter as key audit matter, you're not required to repeat it as an emphasis of matter. So okay. There is a guidance available. I think we can perhaps relook that again. I will also read it.
You've been trying to say something for a very long time, sir.
Thank you. In the auditor's seminar, I'm...
Please, could you please introduce yourself?
My name is Munawar Hamid, and I'm an accounts teacher for the last more than 35 years. So on my profile, there are a number of chartered accountants. They are my students. And the question which came in my mind, it was taken by you, that the question came, a true false question, that revised audit fee means revised remuneration for auditors. But it was already taken. So I thought again, once again, about my students, that due to this revised audit report, what disadvantages will come in the lives of my students who go for audits? Thank you very much.
I don't think we're making the profession any encouraging, actually.
Yes.
Theoretically.
I want that there should be some encouragement for the lives of my students.
Theoretically speaking.
I think it's if you I think the kind of people that we are taking into the profession, because auditors always used to be very silent, not communicating much, very reluctant to interact. So I think now when we intake people, I think we should try to encourage those people who are more talented in terms of communication, in terms of good writing skills.
True.
Because I think that is a skill set which is much needed in the profession. And where, when you are actually in a situation where you explain a lot of work that you do, you need to have people who are good in writing that.
Mm-hmm.
We may be very good in performing an audit technically, but in explaining what we have done is another area. So I think audit firms have to think, while they recruit people, train people, I think they have to add into their training modules about how to write good audit report. They have to attract people who have attended and have skill sets in good writing. It's a talent. You know, you can train people in, but to an extent. So there are people who are very talented in making speeches, in writing, etc. And we may be able to attract those people, retain them, use them in a better way. So I think that is a shift which will happen over time.
I think
who are the countries who have adopted this kind of report? This will be
the UK, Europe, all of the Europe, UK, Australia,
Malaysia, Singapore.
Except for US, most of the countries have adopted.
And PCAOB is also in the process of PCAOB is also.
Critical or
but 2019.
India is also next year.
India's
also.
US maybe 2020
se ho jayega, 2019. UK also you
have
adopted.
UK has adopted.
UK adopted in 2013.
I see.
Okay. There's another question coming in, and I think that will be the last one we'll be taking.
This is Raj from Habib Metropolitan Bank, Finance Department. Sir, I still believe in this, there's still little confusion about what has to be reported in CAMP. Like, initially when we were discussing, we were saying that the significant risk, the items which had significant risk or judgment or something like that, will be reported in CAMP. Later on we move on, no, the matters which have been reported to the board of directors, generally have that kind of matters, will be, we have to fetch something out of it. I think at the top four level, when we think that we need to agree on that, what has to be reported and what should not be reported, the big four should at least agree on that, that what kind of matters to be reported, not standardization on the matters or the wordings or drafting, I'm not saying that, but we should at least agree on that point, what has to be reported and what not has to be reported. Is it clear or not?
Very difficult to agree on a set of standard what needs to be reported
because
it's a different situation for each company.
No, what I'm talking about is the what is written in English, what CAMP means.
Can I try to explain
what CAMP means really?
What your question is, can I try to explain? For example, there was a survey of the risks reported in the audit reports of FRC. And it indicated that impairment of assets were like 86% reported, tax 70%, goodwill impairment 66. Is that what you are actually trying to find out?
Yes.
Okay.
No, is this,
then management override of controls, fraud in revenue recognition, provisions, pensions, acquisitions, investments. So majority of the issues were in impairment of assets, tax, goodwill, management override of control, those kind of things.
No,
so these are the various areas in which CAM is being reported.
Yes, agreed. But just saying that, that these are the matters does not mean that they are the CAM. Like for example,
if you
are making a provision or something.
It's only the topic that we are telling you. It's basically, it's a full description of the whole impairment of asset in a particular company.
Yes.
As to what was the issue of the impairment of asset, how the auditor carried out the procedure and satisfied himself that he actually satisfied with the carrying value of the asset and impairment of asset is not required, for example. Yeah, although it was a significant matter.
Impairment will always be there.
मैं explain कर देता हूँ. आप यूँ समझ लिए बिल्कुल common language के अंदर तीन डब्बे हैं. ठीक है, एक डब्बा जो है वो सिग्निफिकेंट रिस्क का है, जब आपने ऑडिट स्टार्ट किया तो सिग्निफिकेंट रिस्क सारे उसमें भर लें. ठीक है, उसके बाद एक सिग्निफिकेंट एस्टिमेट और जजमेंट का है उसमें भर लें आप. ठीक है, और फिर सिग्निफिकेंट ट्रांजैक्शन या इवेंट्स हैं एक डब्बा आप वो भर लें. ठीक है, इन तीन डब्बों में से आपने कौन से निकाल कर आपने अपनी जजमेंट में दोस्त चार्ज विद गवर्नेंस को बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स को आपने रिपोर्ट किए. ठीक है, अब आपके वो निकल आए. ठीक है, जो आपने इसमें से उनको रिपोर्ट किया है उनमें से वो कौन से मैटर्स हैं जिनके ऊपर आपने सबसे ज़्यादा टाइम लगाया है. ठीक है, मोस्ट सिग्निफिकेंट वर्ड सिग्निफिकेंट से हटके उसके आगे एक मोस्ट लग जाएगा, तो जो मोस्ट सिग्निफिकेंट आइटम है वो आपने कैन के लिए नोट कर लेना है. ठीक है, ये एक छानना है.
यस सर, बिल्कुल
ऊपर से डालते जाएंगे और आखिर में जो निकलना है.
Agreed between the four firms के ऐसे ही है, इसकी understanding ऐसे ही है, या हर key matter को हर
कोई
standard की understanding है. ये standard कह रहा है
हम तो हमें agree होने ना होने से को पता.
It is not agreed between anyone. We have to follow the standard. We have to audit each and every company. और each and every company की specific situation को देख के हमें ये जो फरुख साहब ने डब्बे बनाए ना
yes,
डब्बों में वो डालनी है.
दिस डब्बा विल रिमेन सेम ना सर. नहीं बात है तो पता,
ये तीनों डब्बे आप रखेंगे या एक एक फॉर्म में बांट दें?
दिस इज द लास्ट क्वेश्चन आसिफ प्लीज. Because we're running really short of time.
Thank you very shortly. Thank you very much, Arslan, for detailed presentation. Drafting, as you rightly said, और बाकी लोगों ने भी कहा कि is a very serious issue. Amir साहब will bear me out के एक modified report को differentiate करना, modified, adverse, qualified, उसको बड़ा मुश्किल होता है. तो अब एक पेज से सात पेज, छः पेज पे जाना is going to be, and it's going to be a learning process, as rightly pointed by Farooq. Maybe हम कुछ auditor जो CAM या auditors के काम वाला जो area है उसको हम मे बी आउट ऑफ बॉक्स थिंकिंग के थ्रू उर्दू में एडिशनली, नॉट रिप्लेसिंग, बट उर्दू में कोई ऐसी हम आउट ऑफ बॉक्स सजेशन का सोचें. और मे बी रेगुलेटर्स माइट बी टेकिंग सम सॉर्ट ऑफ अ लीनियंट व्यू, नॉट इन द सेंस.
रिपोर्ट को उर्दू में करना है, वैसे ऑडिटर्स रिपोर्ट उर्दू में देनी होती है.
देनी होती है,
यानी
अभी नहीं,
यानी आएगी वो. डायरेक्टर्स रिपोर्ट तो हो चुकी है.
अच्छा,
Asif, the thing is that more and more training and more practice of the thing is important. Or training, chahe firm mein ho, chahe ICAP mein ho, training is very important. Matlab, usko standard ko samajhna bada zaruri hai, aur uski jo requirements hai, usko samajhna zaruri hai. And then interaction with the audit committee. ये बड़ा ज़रूरी है. अब ये कि उर्दू में ट्रांसलेट करना प्रोबेबली इट विल बी
आस्किंग टू मच.
हाँ, आस्किंग टू मच एट दिस स्टेज.
ऐसी लैंग्वेज में करें जो किसी को समझ ना आए.
इट आल्सो हैज एन इनहेरेंट रिस्क कि आप इंग्लिश में कुछ लिखना चाह रहे हैं उर्दू में, आप ऑडिटर से
मुआवजे लेंगे. यू हैव टू देन वर्क बैकवर्ड्स, उर्दू में ड्राफ्ट करा के उसको इंग्लिश में ट्रांसलेट कर.
तो देन यू माइट बी यू नो डेविएटिंग फ्रॉम द प्रिस्क्राइब्ड.
सी दैट हैज बीन द प्रॉब्लम ऑफ आवर नेशन. हम सोचते हैं उर्दू में, फिर उसको ट्रांसलेट करते हैं. वी नेवर गेट द इंग्लिश राइट. वी नेवर गेट द इंग्लिश राइट. सो लेट्स आई थिंक स्टॉप विद दैट एंड अग्री टू डिसएग्री. एंड अब्दुल रब साहब, थैंक यू वेरी मच ऑल आवर पैनलिस्ट फॉर सच एन इन्फॉर्म्ड डिस्कशन. एंड थैंक यू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स फॉर बीइंग सो पेशेंट विद अस. थैंक यू.
मे रिक्वेस्ट ऑल द पैनलिस्ट टू बी सीटेड for a while, please, for the mementos. Thank you, Hena, for the moderation. And thank you, panelists, for answering the questions and imparting knowledge to our participants. It's time for memento distribution. I request Mr. Farooq Rehman to please do the honors. First memento to Mr. Kamran Mirza. Second to Mr. Amir Jamil Abbasi. So please collect your memento. Mr. Mehmood Abdul Razak. Mr. Yasir Masood. Now our keynote speaker and the panelist, Mr. Arsalan Khalid. And for the session chairman, I would request Mr. Nadeem Adil to please come on stage, the past president and the past council member. One thing I missed for the Hina Sadiq, can you please come on stage and connect your memento from Farooq? Farooq, please. It's a back thing where she sat and like, you know, stuff. Thank you, Hina, and I apologize for the. With this, we conclude our session. I would like to thank the participants and the panelists and the moderator for such a good session. Thank you. Please join us for the tea. Thank you.